Hello and welcome to the BBC Learning English Live Friday Quiz, where today we're looking at food and cooking. Yum, yum. I am your host, Dylan, and we have some great questions for you, as always. We've got vocabulary, grammar, idioms, and as always, a very special mystery guest and much, much more. So let's say hello, tell me your names, where you're from, who you are. Okay. Today's theme is cooking food. So I wanted to get you started. My favorite food is spaghetti bolognese. Originally Italian, it is now a classic dish in households around the UK. What is your favorite meal to cook? Let us know and let me take a look in the comments to see where everybody is from. So we've got Busra saying hello from Turkey, and we've got Abdullah, hello from Iraq. Hi there. We've got Carlos saying hi, and we've got Shubham saying good evening. I'm here in Liverpool in the UK, and it is 1:30 with us, so good afternoon. Jun Hong says, hi from South Korea. Hello, how are you? Lots and lots of people from all over the world saying hello, so a big hello to all of you. Now, let's go through some of the rules before we start. You might know them already, but there are 8 questions. We do the questions first, and we look at the answers at the end. Number 2, it's just for fun. We're here to learn, to get better, to improve ourselves. It's a nice Friday quiz. No prizes involved. The only prize is pride in your own score. Right, number 3 is like, comment, and share. So please, if you are enjoying yourself, if you do think it's a nice quiz, hit that like button. It helps us. And comment, share, let your friends know. If you've got the teachers, family members, friends you think would enjoy this, please let them know. So thank you for joining us. Let's take a look back in the comments. And we've got Juan Humberto saying, hi, good morning from Bolivia. Hello. And we've got, let's have a look, Wang Ailing from Thailand, hello. Sachin from India, lots and lots. And Sergi saying, good afternoon to you. Good afternoon to you. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, wherever you are in the world. And Lucas, is Brazil in the house? All right, one more. We got Samakap from South Africa saying hello. Hello to you all. All right then. So, are you ready for question number 1? Round 1, here we go. And when we move from round to round, I'll do a ding, ding, ding on the bell to signify we're moving on to the next question. Okay, so question number 1 is an idiom about cooking. Okay, complete the idiom, cooking up a wind, A, cooking up a storm, B, or cooking up is a thunder, C. So what is the, complete the idiom, cooking up a wind, cooking up a storm, or cooking up a thunder. Now this idiom has got a few different meanings. One of the main ones is to do a very good job when you're cooking, or to cook for many people. But it can also mean to do something very enthusiastically or with lots of skill. Now, what do you think? Let's take a look what you think. Verity is going for storm, as is Yilin. We've got, is it Jamalksan saying storm. We've got Sanjay going for wind. We've got Lego Films are saying storm, because lots of people are saying B. I like your logic, but is that the correct answer? We'll find out soon. So let me just have one more. Oops. Y Moon saying hello from Myanmar. Hi. And we're going to move on to question number 2. Whoa. Question number 2. Okay. Question number 2 is looking at, what do we call the main chef in a restaurant? The person who is the top chef in a restaurant. Do we call them the head chef, the hat chef, or the above chef? Head chef, hat chef, or above chef? What do you think the answer is? And do we have any chefs or cooks in the house? Let us know about your your job and what you do. And I'm sure that you've got a very good guess about this here. So we've got Vabangari saying head chef. We have got Sachinta also going for head chef. Lots and lots of you going for head chef, number one. Okay, very good today. We've got head chef. Kathy Fernandez. The comments are coming in so fast. Sometimes I lose your name, so apologies about that. We've got a few people saying above chef and a few people saying hat chef, but mostly a head chef. Is it right? Stick around until the end and we will find out. Mariam's also going for head chef. So round three. Lily forgot about that. And we've got, before we move on, Joseph's going, head chef sounds more respectable. So using a bit of logic, it sounds respectable, it sounds right. So that's why you've gone for that choice. Okay, round three. Ooh, okay. So a bit of a grammar question here. Now we've got Sammy, used to work here, recommends the steak. Sammy, used to work here, recommends the steak. Where? A. B, who, C, which, or D, when? Now, steak, I love steak. It's one of my favorite foods. Do you like steak and how do you like it? Rare, medium rare? Well done. And let's come in, lots and lots of different answers. Let's take a look. Okay, we've got Jose going for who? Anastasia going for who? Oof, okay, we got a little bit of Manu saying who? We have got, let's take a look into the comment section here. Who, lots and lots of who. we'll do one more. Amandeep is also going for who. Yes, indeed. So far, so good. It seems like lots of people getting similar answers, let's say. Okay, Sammy, who used to work here, recommends the steak. On to question number four. Question number four. Aha. Now we've got a bit of a vocabulary question here. So let me make it larger for you so you can see it nice and clearly. Which of these words would you not find in a recipe? Which of these would you not find in a recipe? Is it A, dollop, B, dice, C, dagger, or D, dash? What could it be? All right, then. So let's take a look what you say. We've got Kushwa saying dollop. We've got Joshina going for dice. We've got Dagger from Divya. Elza, dice. So I like this. There's a bit more variety in the answers here. I think you're not quite sure about this one. So a little bit more difficult for this question. We've got C. Thien going for C. Yilin is saying dagger is a knife. But does that mean you find it in a recipe or not? We'll find out soon. So remember, we'll do the questions first and the answers at the end. So good job. Lots and lots of answers flying in. A nice variety summed up by Stella, who says, I have no idea. And Jun Hong said, this is dice. But can dice have more than one meaning? I suppose that's the big question, isn't it? All right, then. So well done, everybody. Lots and lots of answers flying in. Okay, and round number five, my favorite round. And this is where we get our special mystery guest. Now, you have seen this guest before. He's very popular, very well liked on this channel. Who could it be?
Hello. Hello.
Fantastic. Hello again, my friend. It is Roy. How are you?
I'm very well, mate. I'm very well. Thank you very much. It's very, very stormy. It's very windy here. I don't know if you can see the trees behind me. It's crazy where I am, but I'm good.
Yeah. So how have you been, Roy?
Yeah, pretty good. Working hard and eating well to keep in with the theme and very much enjoying today's quiz.
Good. And do you like to cook?
No, I love it. I absolutely love cooking. Like, give me any excuse, any opportunity, friends, family. You know, I love cooking for my kid. Summer comes along, I've got the barbecue out. I will, you know, through the winter, I'll be making. I love cooking. I adore it.
What is your speciality?
Well, I try very hard to make a very, very nice curry. My family seem to like it when I cook it. But the difference, one thing about my curry, there is no meat in my curry because I don't eat meat. My wife and son eat meat, but I don't eat meat.
Okay, and I believe that links to your question today.
Very nicely, doesn't it? What is the word for people like me who don't eat meat, but they do eat things like eggs, cheese, and milk? So what is the word, and I'm looking for the spelling, what is the word, I know spelling is important, right? What is the word that describes a person who doesn't eat meat, but does eat things dairy? We say dairy, like milk, cheese, and eggs.
Okay, and they only get the point if they spell it correctly, correct?
Yep. Not it. They need to spell the word right. Not it, but never. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So everybody get your comments coming in and we'll check it in very soon. Roy, if they want to see you next, where can they find you?
Well, next, probably if our wonderful viewers want to check out The English We Speak, it's actually more of a listening thing. So you can hear that on our podcast, on our website, bbclearningenglish.com, and of course on our app. And that's called The English We Speak. And it's like a little phrase or expression that we commonly use in English.
Right, perfect. Thanks very much for your question. And lots of people saying hello to you.
Hello to everybody. Hello. It's lovely to see you.
Okay. So see you soon.
Take care. See ya. Bye. Bye-bye.
Okay, everybody. Let's take a look in the comments. And we've got lots of people saying, okay. We've got Liliana saying vegetarian. Ngo saying, I can't understand. The question is, what do you call somebody who does not eat meat, but they eat things like eggs, milk, eggs, honey, and they drink milk? Okay. We got Chonthicha saying vegetarian. We've got Safa, lots of the spelling seem quite consistent, so that's a good sign. We've got a good answer here. Sorry, I'm just looking for this. So Sachin has gone vegan/vegetarian. Now, what's the difference between a vegan and a vegetarian? Let me know if you think you know the answer to that question. And do we have any vegetarians here yourself? So we've got vegetarian. Flexitarian. With a look at that word later on, I'll explain some of these words. And Rendy is asking, is vegan vegetarian? Is it the same? When we go through the answers, I'll explain all. So stick around. All right. Question number six, round six. Here we go. Round six. Now, we've got a 3-point question for this, taking our total up to 10 points. Can you name these three kitchen utensils? So for this, I will not give you multiple choice. I want you to spell and write the name of these three different kitchen utensils into the comments box, please. So these are very commonly used in the UK. The first one I use for flipping eggs. Second one for cutting all the ingredients, and the third mainly for cheese. Now, what are they called? So let's have a look. I'm going to check into the comment section. We've got ladle, knife, and grater from Jans. We've got Flyaway saying it's a knife. Spatula, knife, grater. Okay. I only know the middle one. If you only know the middle one, let me know what it is. 1 point for each. 3 points if you get all three. And 1 point for each of them. All right, then. Nice. That's all I know. If you only know one, that's no problem. We've got slicer, knife, and a chancer. Is that correct? We're going to find out soon. And last one, Tutu says spatula, knife, and a grater. On to question number seven. Round seven, here we go. Round seven. I've put a missing word here. And I'm going to ask, what word goes best in the blank space here? I love to be able to cook well. What word can we use here? So we're looking at a hypothetical or a desired situation, something you want to be true, but isn't true at the moment. So what word goes into the blank space? All right, and I can see lots of people saying the right answer. Some people go, oh, not so sure. But we've got, oh, Renia just saying hello from Mexico. Hello. To anybody who's just joined us, this is the BBC Learning English Live Friday quiz. We're on question number seven. We do the questions first. We look at the answers at the end. Calvin's going for wood. Mai is also going for wood. Lots and lots of wood. We've got some people saying, should. Let's have a look. We got a lot of people for I'd. Interesting. Okay. So the apostrophe D, what is that short for? What is that a contraction of? All right then. And we'll move on. So lots and lots of woods coming in. But is that the correct answer? Stick around to find out, and we'll explain all at the end. Okay, round eight. Okay, our final question before we go through the answers, which of course is the important part. All right. And here is a punctuation question, which students often find difficult, okay? And even native speakers find this tricky sometimes. And we're going to put, please put the recipe book back in place. So could it be it apostrophe S, it's with no apostrophe, it is, or it's with an apostrophe at the end? And let's take a look. We've got Evgeny going for it. We've got Estella going for B. We've got Ashna going for B, it's. Whoa, comments are flying in. Let me try and catch one. Whoops. Kov is going for it, apostrophe S. Is it Saluka? Is going for D. So a little bit of a wide variety of opinion here. Lots of Bs, but also lots of A and a few Ds. Nobody for C. So I'll give you a clue. It's not C. So well done, everybody there. All right. So, okay, that is the end of the questions. Time for the answers. Now, before we move on, let me know, how many do you think you got right? So today we've got 10 points, because there's 8 questions, but one of them was worth 3 points. How many do you think you get? How confident are you? And we're going to go through the answers right now. So let's check it out. So round one. So round one was an idiom looking at, so let's take a look at what you think first. So it's an idiom related to cooking. It has a few different meanings, and it can mean you've done a very good job with the cooking, you've cooked a delicious meal, or you've cooked for many people. It can mean that you do something with a lot of energy or skill. Or it can mean that you've caused a little bit of trouble. So what's the correct answer, do you think? And we got dun, dun, dun. It is B, cooking up a storm. So yes, if you're cooking a big meal for many people, you can say, I'm cooking up a storm. You're cooking a big meal. Or you're doing a really good job. Excuse me. You're cooking something special or unusual or delicious. I'm cooking up a storm. Something that is very popular or done with a lot of skill, you can also say cooking up a storm. So my friend's new video is cooking up a storm on social media. or if you're causing a lot of trouble, we can say cooking up a storm. So Freddie caused a lot of trouble in the bar last night. Security had to kick him out. He cooked up a storm. So three different meanings of that. Did you get that one, Dave? Yes, I'm right. Well done, Dave. Okay. Thin is feeling confident. 8 out of 10. That's a pretty good score. We've got Erwin, 1 point already. Well done, as has Angel or Angel. And can you see my comment? Yes, I can, but there's lots and lots of them coming in. I'd like to put all your names up, but whew, they fly in very, very fast. Okay, so well done if you got that one correct. Now, remember, if you'd like any more information on any of the topics we cover here, be sure to go to bbclearningenglish.com. Check us out on YouTube, BBC Learn English, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. We've got loads and loads of materials about idioms because we love idioms. Loads and loads of opportunities to learn. Okay. And if Janie, we can also say to be in the eye of a storm, and that means to be in the middle of a chaotic situation. Yes. So thank you very much for that. Do you know any other storm idioms? And if you do, share them. Is this a British idiom? Asked Swelly. I don't believe so. I believe that this would be common in North America and the rest of the world as well. I don't believe that this is just for the UK. I think I've heard it in many places. Okay, round two, which was a question that seemed that many of you are quite confident about, actually. Okay, and let's take a look. So it's a question about the main chef, the top chef, the most important chef in the kitchen. Now, do we have any chefs here, any cooks here? Was the answer A, head chef, B, hat chef, or C, above chef? And yes, the answer, as many, many of you got correct, was head chef. So well done if you got that correct. So the head chef is in charge of the kitchen. They often design the menu. They take all the main decisions. Sometimes they're known as master chef or executive chef. So head chef, master chef, executive chef, all of these. Another thing, chef and cook are words that are sometimes confused by learners. But the main difference is the level of experience and education. So if you say you are a chef, it implies that you have had a formal education in culinary skills or cooking. So chef implies you've been, it's a professional job and that you have had a formal education and that you have quite a lot of experience. Whereas cook may be somebody who prepares and makes food, but has not had a formal education. So that's kind of the difference there. Now, did you get that one correct? So well done, Juan Humberto. 2 out of 8. Good. Nice, Verity. We've got a chef in the house. What's your speciality? High five. High five to everyone who got that right. Well done. We've got more. Lots and lots of you are chefs. Many people are coming in saying that they are chefs. We've seen that one, Verity. We've got, yes, got it right from Habit. And Milan is saying 1 out of 2, not bad. Okay, not bad at all. On to question number 3. Here we go. And we've got, this is the question. I think that you did quite well on this one. But it's Sammy. Used to work here, recommends the steak. Now, do we choose the pronoun that goes with work, the place, or do we use Sammy, the person? And that's the main question here. All right. And the answer is B, who? Now, this is an example of using a relative pronoun in a non-defining relative clause. So a non-defining relative clause adds extra information. So this means we could have just said Sammy recommends the steak, but we've used a non-defining relative clause to add information. And we do this by using noun or noun phrase, then a comma, relative pronoun and extra information, comma, and then the rest of the clause. So it's easy to identify these by identify a non-defining relative clause because it has a comma directly after the noun. We use the noun who because we are talking about the person Sammy who was at the start of the sentence. If we had used a place as the noun at the start, we would have used where. For example, Bella Steaks, where Sammy used to work, has delicious food. Or if we'd used a time at the start, we would have used when. So last year, when Sammy was working here, she used to give me free meals. So we look at the first word in the sentence, and that can tell us whether we should use who, which, when, where, etc. Okay, so did you get that correct? We got Om got it correct. Well done. All right. Yeah, it's who. Yes, it is. Nice. We've got a restaurant owner here, so a perfect theme for you today. It's who. We got Rosemary saying how to pronounce steak. 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 Okay, I hope that helps. Steak. And we've got Verity saying, wow, 3 out of 8 already. Well done. And we've got Sachintha going for 2 out of 3. What is the meaning of steak? So steak is a slice of meat, a slice of beef, so a slice of cow that is usually fried or put in a grill. Gets a very classic Western dish and popular around the world, really. Oh, and I'm jealous. All this talk is making me hungry, and your goose is eating steak right now. Oh, not fair. Shh, don't tell me. All right. So lots of people saying how to pronounce schedule, how to pronounce television. If you join us at 1:30 on Tuesdays and Thursdays, Catherine and Ian will help you with your pronunciation questions. Today's the live quiz. So speaking of the quiz, we're going to move on to question number 4, which was one that I liked. Okay. Which of these words would you not find in a recipe? Dollop, dice, dagger, or dash? Dollop, dice, dagger, and dash. And I'll check your answers soon. Laura is asking, where am I from? What's my accent? I am from Wales in the UK, but I live in Liverpool at the moment, but I'm from South Wales, a small town called Llanelli, if you've heard of that. It's a small town not many people will have. Okay, so Anna's asking, please explain every single word. I will, Anna, don't worry about that. That is my plan, okay? So what's recipe is asking Potima. A recipe is a list of instructions to say how to cook a meal. So maybe you want to cook a new meal, but you don't know how. So you look online and somebody else explains. They say, okay, first you slice the onion, you put it in the pan. This is the recipe. Okay. We've got, so let's have a look. Chonthikcha is going for a dollop. We've got Daga from Bithka and a big hello from AP. All right. So the correct answer is dun, 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 dagger. Okay. So a dagger is not something we'd expect to find in a recipe, not in a kitchen. Now, while we do use kitchen knives and a wide variety of them, daggers are used mainly as a weapon. So we wouldn't find them in a kitchen. So a dagger looks like a knife, but it's bigger and longer usually. And it is used as a weapon. Now, a dollop, is a large, shapeless mass of soft food. So especially a sauce or cream. So the recipe might say, add a dollop of hot sauce. And it just means a big lump of it. Not very specific, just a big lump. And we use it with sauces, so like mayonnaise and ketchup, hot sauce. A dollop is just a big, big spoonful. What else? Dice is a verb meaning to cut into squares. So you know the shape and size of a dice? That is what we do with meat or vegetables. If we put them into small square shapes, we dice them. Now, a dash just means a little bit of something, especially a liquid or powder. So you might add a dash of orange flavor to your water, or you might add a dash of salt to your dish, or a dash of spice, meaning a little bit. Okay, any questions about that? Okay, Laura, like the dagger in Othello, exactly, or like the daggers in Game of Thrones, exactly that. Okay, and we got Manasa saying, I thought dagger may be used for cutting, and that's why I put it in as a little trick question for you. IPEC is saying a dash of salt, exactly that. Very, very common way of saying a little bit of an ingredient. Or Vam Shirk Krishna is saying, I've learned a lot. That's what we love to hear. We're here to teach and have a little bit of fun. Okay. Padma was wrong, but don't worry. Keep on trying. Okay. And Anna says, I'll say theatre four because I know none of these words and I copy the answer. I appreciate your honesty. Okay, and we've got one more question. Dollop is of opposite to dash. Not really the opposite. Dollop is used for soft foods, creams and sauces mainly. And it means quite a large spoonful of this soft food. We use a dash for liquid or for powder spice like salt or pepper or spices, or for liquid. Okay, so not quite the opposite. Whew. All right, so on we go to round five. And round five was Roy's question. Now, Roy's question was, what do you call somebody who does not eat meat, but they do eat dairy? And dairy means products that come from an animal, but not the animal itself. So milk and honey and cheese and eggs are all examples of dairy foods. So what do we call somebody who does not eat meat? And we call them a vegetarian. So we've got lots of people saying vegetarians, lots and lots of that in the comments. So somebody who doesn't eat meat, but who eats cheese and eggs and milk and honey, we call a vegetarian. Somebody who doesn't eat any animal products, so no meat, no eggs, no milk, no honey, no dairy, we call them vegan. A pescatarian avoids meat from birds and mammals, but they do eat fish and seafood. So pescatarian doesn't eat birds and mammals, red or white meat, but they do eat fish and seafood. And then there's a new word, or quite a word that's become common recently called flexitarian. Now, a flexitarian avoids meat 90% of the time, but sometimes they do. Okay, so that's a flexitarian. Now, what is your diet like? Do you have any special diets here? Anna says, I eat everything. Okay. I misunderstood. It's a vegetarian. Okay. Somebody with meat is a carnivore, especially with animals. We use the word carnivore. And there's something called the carnivore diet, which has become increasingly popular in the last 2 years, it seems to me. And that's when people only eat meat. Okay, vegan theater five. So not quite, because a vegan does eat dairy. All right. I don't eat melted cheese. I don't think there's a word for that. It's very, very specific. And Sumaya says, can you repeat the word for someone who eats fish and seafood but doesn't eat meat? Yes, I can. It's pescatarian. And I'm going to put that into the comments so you can see the spelling as well. Pescatarians. As somebody who eats fish and seafood, doesn't eat meat. Okay. All right, then. We got one or two more comments. Fatima loves dairy. And again, tell about flexitarian. So flexitarian Salah is somebody who most days does not eat meat. Maybe they don't eat meat for 1 month, no problem. But then it's their birthday or they go to somebody's house and they've cooked meat. So, and they will eat it. So they're flexible. So the flex comes from flexible. It means they usually don't, but sometimes they do. All right. And pescatarian, thank you, Eman. Well, I think it's Eman. Round six. Three more questions to go. And three. Yes. Now, this was a kitchen utensil vocabulary question. And this one caused a few problems there. Now, these are all very common kitchen utensils we use all the time in the UK. Do you use them a lot in your country or your region? Let us know. And what are they called? It is called, or they are called, a spatula. Now, a spatula, and I'll repeat the pronunciation, spatula, is a kitchen utensil. It has a wide, flat blade, and it's commonly used to flip eggs and to mix or to stir foods. It's an essential part of a British kitchen. I use it every single day. I use a spatula. Number two, nice and easy, is a knife. It's a sharp kitchen knife. Remember, if we talk about more than one knife, we say knives with a V in the middle. One knife, two knives. And number three is a grater. Sometimes people call it a cheese grater or a food grater, but you can just keep it simple and call it a grater if you like. I call it a grater. And I personally use it for grating cheese, carrots, sometimes ginger, but there's a whole wide variety of things we use to take something large and to grind it, to grate it into smaller pieces. Now, did you get that correct? Ayaz is also saying, I eat everything. Okay. We got correct. Well done. All right. Catherine is saying spatula is great for pancake. Okay. Abuka is saying, I do use them, but I don't know their names. Well, you do now. Okay. So spatula, knife, grater. And let's take a look. Yeah, Laura Pat, knives, as I said. Yes, good. Thank you. And a good point. So Adnan says grater and grater sound the same in terms of pronunciation. Yes, it's a homophone, meaning they sound the same. Thai is asking, why do we need a grater? So maybe you have, so let's say a carrot. And it's, you know, a big carrot like this. And you rub it against the side of the grater. And in the middle comes out small pieces of this, of the food. Okay. Ireri's asking, are you Scottish or Irish? No, I'm not. I'm Welsh. I'm from Wales. Okay. All right, let's take a look. See any more comments? We've got last one. Oops, sorry, I lost that then. Grater, I hope it's clear now. We rub food against it to make it into smaller and smaller pieces. Utensils, kitchen utensils. And these are the different items we use within the kitchen. So chopsticks, knife, fork, these items, spatula, ladle. These are all kitchen utensils. Okay, then. So Okay, if you want to make friends, that's all great. Perfect. Okay. Let's take a look at round seven. Round seven. Okay, this was where I let you choose the answer. I didn't give you multiple choice, so it takes a bit more brain power. Yeah. So I love to be able to cook well. Now, there could be a few different options here, but I think there's one that is most obvious, that I think most people would put here, and it is I would. Okay, I would love to be able to cook well. The answer here is would, which is an auxiliary verb. And we use it to talk about an imaginary but desired situation. So we're thinking about and imagining being good at cooking. We're hoping that one day, or it's a desire for you to become good at cooking. So to do this, we use subject plus would plus the base form of the verb followed by the rest of the sentence. So I would love to learn karate. My friend Tina would like to go to India. Pablo would love a new car, but unfortunately he can't afford one. So you can make your own examples using what would you love to have or to do? What would you love to have or do? All right, so let's take a look in the comment section. Lots and lots of you saying would, and we got Diego Costa saying, I'd love to be able to speak English like you. Diego, practice makes perfect. You're in the right place. Okay, sign up for the BBC Learning English app. Check out our website. Practice every day, and you will get there. All our languages is practice. Okay, so good luck to Diego and to everybody. Ireri saying, I would love to learn more cooking recipes. Me too, actually. That's one of my goals. My New Year's resolution for this year is to learn to cook better. We've got Mariam. Same as with Diego. Keep up the good work. You're in the right place. You're studying. It's Friday. You're practicing. We can do it. Together we will practice and we will get better at learning the language. Okay, then. So we have got Maribel, I would love to be a teacher in BBC. Maybe one day. Aim high. Go for your goals. And we've got Gabriella saying, I would love to go back to work after this pandemic. We're all hoping for the same. Look at me, working from my home rather than the BBC studios. I look forward to going back to work myself. All right, then. And let's take a look. And Emma is asking, I would love to be a good doctor. Good luck in your dreams. All right. Which one is the 3 point question? The 3 point question is the one with the spatula, knife, and grater. 1 point for each of those. And the last question, here we go. Please put the recipe book back in place. So back in, and we go through this relatively quickly, back in its place. Okay, so it's a bit of a tricky one. And don't worry if you didn't get it, because even native speakers get this one wrong quite often. So it apostrophe S, A. Okay, the first one is a contraction of it is. Instead of saying it is good, we can say it's good. Instead of saying it is rainy, we can say it's rainy. So we can use apostrophe S, it apostrophe S, anytime where we could also say it is. Okay, so far so good. It's, okay, choice B with no apostrophe, is a possessive word like his or her or our. It shows that something belongs to somebody or it belongs somewhere else or it belongs to something. It is the possessive word or possessive form of the word it. The horse was in its stable, so it's no apostrophe because it's possessive. The bank raised its fees. The bank's in control of the fees. It's their fees to raise or lower. So we can use, or we should use, it's no apostrophe. So if you cannot replace the word with it is, we do not use an apostrophe. If we can replace it with it is, we do use an apostrophe. Now, did you get that one correct? Okay. Dun, 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 dun. Lots of people saying they got it correct. So well done to everybody. Okay. So Verity, 5 out of 8. Pretty good. Not bad at all. Ashraf, 8 out of 10. We've got Jashandeep, 7 out of 10. So good job. Okay. What else have you got here? Bushra, 7 out of 8. Remember, everybody, don't compare yourself with each other. It's what you feel proud or confident about. If you have learned something today, then that's what all that matters. If you've learned one new word and it sticks with you, perfect. If you learned 2 new words and a grammar point, perfect. So if you didn't get them all correct, don't stress, don't worry, don't beat yourself up. We're here to learn. I'm here to help. And we're together going to improve our English. Okay? So well done, everybody. We've got, honestly, 6. We've got to be honest. So well done, 6 out of 8. Well done, Marseille, 10 out of 10. So we've got a nice question. Dave, will you come tomorrow BBC Live? No. So on Tuesday and Thursday at 1:30, we do pronunciation live. That's where Ian and Catherine will just take your pronunciation questions and improve your speaking skills. On Wednesdays, we have different teachers, and they come and they help you with your grammar or vocabulary. And then on Friday, we do the quiz together, where we do 8 questions and we practice and we try and improve and learn a little bit together. How about that? So that's the schedule. Jose, I'm proud of learning every day. That's all we can do. Well done. Anna, good luck, Anna. Okay, Colonel Sammy, 1 out of 10 this week. Let's see what happens next week. The only way is up. Okay, so there you are. And we got lots of thank yous. Thank you very much. You, thanks, Maribel. Nice teaching, says Verity. Welsh, do you like Lambert? Of course I do. I love it. It's a traditional Welsh food. Thanks for that. I learned a lot today. Thank you. Great. So I'm going to finish now. But remember, check out bbclearningenglish.com. You can download our app. You can check us out on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. And and you can come back and see us next week for all our live lessons, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday at 1:30. Okay. Thanks for joining. Bye.